Hey everyone, Adam Simmons here from DGTL Infra, short for Digital Infrastructure. Fiber is bringing you gigabit internet speeds, and in the coming years, 5 to 10 times these gigabit speeds. In part two of this two-part series, I'm going to give you an overview of consumer-facing fiber, which can also be thought of as fiber-based broadband connectivity. Specifically, we dive into two of the most common ways in which fiber is deployed to your home, who the top 10 US broadband providers are, and explain why the cable companies currently dominate the United States broadband market. You'll have a better understanding of how fiber is affecting your internet speeds at home, so stay tuned and I will break this all down for you. Before I do, be sure to subscribe to the DGTL Infra channel and turn on the notifications so you don't miss my next in-depth video that is coming out soon. Now, let's jump into the video. So just to reiterate from our last video, fiber optic cables consist of bundled glass strands that transfer data signals into optical light. Optical equipment is used to transform these data signals into light that travels along fiber threads and is reconverted at the other end of the fiber strand. So fiber is that glue that connects your home computer to the internet. And once again, just to frame out where we are in the digital infrastructure ecosystem, fiber is a part of digital infrastructure that has numerous applications. Indeed, there are two overall categories that we can group fiber into in order to help differentiate its various business models. First is business-to-business fiber, also referred to as B2B fiber. This includes dark fiber, which is also known as wholesale fiber, and enterprise fiber. We covered both dark fiber and enterprise fiber in our last video, which was part one of this two-part series, so I won't spend too much time on it now. In part two of this two-part series, we will be focusing on business-to-consumer or B2C fiber. This can also be thought of as fiber-based broadband connectivity. So business-to-consumer fiber, or broadband, has its deployments fall into two different categories. First is fiber to the node, which abbreviated is FTTN, and companies like AT&T and Lumen Technologies are examples of companies that have the largest fiber to the node deployments. Second is fiber to the home, which abbreviated is FTTH, and in this subsegment, Verizon Fios is an example of one of the largest fiber to the home deployments. So if we start with fiber to the node, or FTTN, this network is designed so that fiber is terminated in a street cabinet or pole at the edge of a neighborhood, with the final connection to the customer's home using the existing copper telephone lines. DSL, also known as digital subscriber line technology, is used between the neighborhood cabinet and the consumer. The area is served by the node, which is typically less than 1 mile away and may connect up to several hundred customer homes. The drawback of fiber to the node networks is the limitations of that last mile copper line, which reduces speed and capacity depending on the distance the signal must travel over copper instead of fiber. Rather than extending fiber directly to the home through a fiber build, telecom providers have the option of increasing capacity by pushing fiber closer to the customer's home, which is a quicker and cheaper method for those providers to upgrade their connectivity. However, what is cheaper for the telecom provider is inferior for the consumer. So let's walk through some of the key components of fiber to the node network architecture to get a better understanding of what distinguishes it from fiber to the home. So fiber to the node, or FTTN, networks have four key components. First is the headend. This is a permanent, secure facility housing the electronics to provide cable services in a given market. The headend represents the aggregation point for broadcast video, satellite transmission, and the internet in a particular market. The headend is ideally located near an internet exchange point, known as an IXP, and also a power grid. As seen through the diagram, the networks are pushing electronics to the hubs and nodes, freeing up space at the headend and becoming cloud ready. The second component of fiber to the node networks is the hub. This is a smaller shelter connected with fiber and located in the local community. Each hub serves about 50 nodes from different communities. networks are pushing electronics and functions to the field, freeing up space at the hub and becoming cloud-enabled as well. The third component of fiber to the node network architecture is the node. This is a small box, often situated along power lines, serving a local neighborhood. The node is the boundary between fiber and coaxial cable infrastructure. Optical nodes have fiber connectivity, reducing the need for downstream traditional amplifiers, which are signified by the pink triangles with dark blue borders in the video. Each node can serve several hundred customer homes. Nodes are being equipped with additional electronics for more capabilities, and in turn, this frees up space in the headend and the hub. The fourth component of fiber to the node networks is the amplifier, which is signified by the pink triangles with dark blue borders. Amplifiers are located between the node and the home and are used to amplify the legacy signal that travels over copper. Now let's walk through some of the key components of the fiber to the home, or FTTH, network architecture to get a better understanding of what distinguishes it from fiber to the node, or FTTN. Fiber to the home, or FTTH, is where fiber is extended all the way to the customer's home. This is likely done through a box on the outside wall of a home, rather than to the neighborhood cabinet used for fiber to the node builds. Given the proximity to the end user and a better connection, fiber to the home networks offer the fastest speeds, but with the drawback of being a higher cost to deploy for the telecom provider. Typical fiber to the home speeds range from 100 megabits per second to 1 gigabit per second and offer the greatest competition to cable services, which are deployed on hybrid fiber coaxial networks. However, given the formidable costs associated with a dense fiber to the home build-out, the scale of these services will be limited to about 1/3 of total US homes. This is where it would be economical for telecom providers to build out fiber to the home. So now with that background of fiber to the node and fiber to the home in mind, let's move on to the different broadband subscribers by platform. So before diving into the 10 largest cable and telecom broadband companies, it is important to understand the overall composition of how Americans receive their broadband connectivity. Overall, the United States has 112 million broadband subscribers, which receive broadband from one of the three types of service providers. First is cable, with 76.3 million subscribers and a 68% market share of broadband connectivity. Second are telecom providers, with 33.2 million subscribers and a 30% market share connectivity. So together, cable and telecom provide 98% of broadband connectivity to different customers in the United States. The remaining 2% market share is from satellite services, which currently have 2.2 million subscribers. It's worth noting a few things about these different platforms. So cable is taking subscriber share from telecom companies, given that telecom companies' subscriber numbers are actually declining year over year, whereas cable is growing its subscriber base at about 6-7% per year. Additionally, while satellites may only provide 2% of broadband connectivity nationwide, their services are improving, with low Earth orbit or LEO-based constellations like Starlink. If you want to learn more about Starlink, check out our two-part series with video one titled Starlink, Project Kuiper and Satellite Broadband, and video two titled Starlink Deep Dive and How It Works, which we'll link to below as well. So now with that background on the overall broadband market in the United States in mind, let's run through the top 10 cable and telco broadband companies by subscribers. So first is Comcast Corporation. And Comcast, which mainly operates under its brand Xfinity, has 30.1 million broadband subscribers in the United States. Second is Charter Communications, which operates under its brand Spectrum. And Charter has 28.6 million broadband subscribers in the United States. Third is AT&T, which operates under this flagship brand and has 15.4 million subscribers in the United States. It's worth noting that AT&T also passes 14 million homes with fiber connectivity. Fourth is Verizon Communications, which for fiber operates under the brand Fios. And Verizon has 7.1 million subscribers in the United States. It's also worth noting that Verizon passes significantly more homes with fiber than its current installed subscriber base, and that fiber passing number is 18.5 million households. Fifth is Cox Communication, which operates under the brand Cox and has 6.1 million subscribers in the United States. Sixth is Lumen Technologies, which operates under both the brands Lumen and its former name CenturyLink. Lumen has 5.1 million subscribers in the United States, and overall it passes 2.3 million homes with fiber connectivity. Seventh is Altice USA, which operates under two different brands, depending on the region, called Optimum and Suddenlink. Overall, Altice has 4.7 million broadband subscribers. Eighth is Frontier Communications. Operating under the brand Frontier, the company has 3.2 million subscribers in the United States and passes 3 million homes with fiber connectivity. Ninth is Mediacom Communications, which operates under the brand Extreme. Mediacom has 1.4 million subscribers across the United States. And finally, number 10 is Windstream, which operates under the brand Kinetic and has 1.1 million subscribers in the United States. So one question we get asked a lot is, if fiber is so important, why do cable companies dominate the US broadband market share? Cable companies use what is known as hybrid fiber coaxial networks to deploy their broadband services. So cable has the ability to serve about 90% of the 126 million American households with speeds of at least 100 megabits per second. Additionally, speeds of 1 gigabit per second service are available to most households. If we compare cable to legacy telecom companies, these telecom companies typically offer service in three major tiers. So for the top one-third of US homes, they are fully competitive with cable. There are about 40 million homes that have a fiber-based broadband option from telecom providers, which is a perfect substitute for cable. There's also a middle third of US homes which have a value alternative to cable available to them. And this offers speeds in the 50 megabits per second to 100 megabits per second range. Finally, the bottom one-third of US homes is effectively a cable monopoly, as the legacy telecom providers offer speeds of less than 50 megabits per second, and in many areas, less than 20 megabits per second. Additionally, 5 to 10% of homes have no cable option and weak telecom-based services. So comparing cable to these telecom companies, overall cable has developed a cost-effective way to deliver comparable broadband services in the form of speeds to both consumers and businesses. And because of this, cable companies are taking a significant number of broadband subscribers from telecom providers' lower speed digital subscriber line, also known as DSL, offerings. In order to remain competitive, fiber needs to be built out to additional homes by companies like AT&T, Verizon, Lumen, and Frontier, amongst others. So with all that said, if you are one of the households still using a DSL line, we'd highly recommend looking at a cable alternative if it were to be available in your market and your telecom provider doesn't offer you fiber-based services, because you'll likely be paying the same amount for markedly faster internet speeds. Finally, it's worth mentioning that DGTL Infra has created two in-depth videos on specific companies and their unique strategies both in the fiber to the home space and cable company sector. If you are interested in learning more, we recommend checking out these two. So first, if you want to learn more about the economics of a specific fiber to the home build-out, check out our video on Consolidated Communications called Why Fiber Investors Are Bringing You Gigabit Internet. Second, we did a video on the convergence of fiber companies and cable companies. If you want to learn more about why cable companies are considered as a way to play the fiber theme of digital infrastructure, and ultimately the convergence going on between publicly traded fiber companies and publicly traded cable companies, then check out our video on Astound Broadband called TPG Sells Astound Broadband for $8.1 billion to Stonepeak. So hopefully you found this video on fiber-based broadband connectivity and our two-part series on fiber helpful. If you did, then please share it with somebody you think might also find it helpful, and consider subscribing to DGTL Infra and visit us at dgtlinfra.com for more of the latest news on digital infrastructure. Thank you for watching this video. Be sure to like the video and post in the comments telling me what broadband service you have and whether it is fiber, cable, DSL, or something else. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.